Meine Damen und Herren, ich möchte Sie alle ganz, ganz herzlich zu unserer Vogel-Lecture 2022 begrüßen. Und natürlich in unser aller Namen möchte ich unsere heutige Vortragende, Luisa de Cola, hier vorrangig begrüßen. Ich möchte hier eigentlich nur aus der zweiten Reihe sprechen, denn die erste Reihe möchte ich gerne unserer geschäftsführenden Direktorin, unserer neuen Kollegin Stefanie Katz-Schor überlassen, die allerdings aufgrund einer Erkrankung heute selbst nicht hier sein kann. Sie hat aber was sehr Hübsches geliefert, nämlich ein kleines Video. Und ich versuche jetzt mal, das hier zu aktivieren.
Sehr geehrte Frau Professor de Cola, sehr geehrte Frau Vogel, sehr geehrter Herr Dr. Pfaff, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, verehrte Gäste. Ich darf Sie ganz herzlich im Namen des Instituts für Organische Chemie zur diesjährigen Emanuel-Vogel-Vorlesung an der Universität zu Köln begrüßen. Ich freue mich sehr, dass diese traditionsreiche Veranstaltung nach so langer Zeit endlich wieder stattfinden kann. Ich bedauere sehr, dass ich aufgrund einer Corona-Infektion heute nicht persönlich bei Ihnen sein kann. Es wäre für mich eine Premiere gewesen, meine erste Emanuel-Vogel-Vorlesung seit meinem Start hier in Köln im Herbst 2020. Ich freue mich mit Ihnen auf eine spannende Veranstaltung und wünsche Ihnen einen angeregten Austausch sowohl auf wissenschaftlicher als auch auf persönlicher Ebene.
Ja, und nun ist es an mir, den Namensgeber der Vogel-Lecture, Professor Dr. Dr. H.C. Mult Emanuel Vogel, noch einmal zu würdigen. Herr Vogel, Sie sehen hier ein Bild von ihm, wurde am 2. Dezember 1927 geboren, er ist am 31. März 2011 verstorben. Emanuel Vogel kam als vergleichsweise junger Kollege nach Köln. Er war, wenn ich das richtig gerechnet habe, gerade mal 34 Jahre alt, als er die Nachfolge des Nobelpreisträgers Kurt Alder antrat. Das war 1961. Und er blieb über 30 Jahre hier in Köln auf dem Lehrstuhl für organische Chemie, bis er Mitte der 90er Jahre emeritiert wurde. Und seine Nachfolge hat Albrecht Berghessel angetreten, den ich auch hier heute begrüße. Ich freue mich, Albrecht, dich auch bei der Gelegenheit zu sehen. Corona hat uns zum Teil sehr auseinandergebracht. Aber das lässt sich alles wieder neu einfädeln. Und Albrecht Berghessel wurde im Sommer letzten Jahres in den Ruhestand geschickt. Und seine Nachfolgerin im Grunde ist Stefanie Katz-Schor. Und Sie sehen, sie ist schon kurz vor Albrechts Ausscheiden hier gestartet, weil es uns gelungen ist, sie hier über eine Bund-Länder-Professur quasi vorzeitig zu platzieren. Gott sei Dank. Und Sie haben sie ja eben in Ihrer Ansprache, in Ihren Grußworten kurz erleben dürfen. Aber zurück zu Emanuel Vogel. Ich sage zu unseren Studierenden immer, wir arbeiten auf den Schultern von Giganten. Und es war nicht nur Kurt Alder, nach dem dieser Hörsaal benannt ist, sondern auch Emanuel Vogel, der dafür gesorgt hat, dass die organische Chemie hier in Köln wirklich international Aufmerksamkeit gefunden hat. Ein Beispiel, was wir auch heute noch den Studierenden beibringen, ist das Methanocen-Anulen, der Vogelaromat, der trotz seiner ungewöhnlichen Struktur volle aromatische Eigenschaften zeigt. Und das kam beispielsweise 1964 in die Chemical and Engineering News der ACS nach dem Motto Chemists from the Institute of Organic Chemistry of the University of Köln. Wer sich für das Werk von Emanuel Vogel so aus der eigenen reifen Perspektive nochmal so einen Überblick verschaffen möchte, dem möchte ich diesen Artikel empfehlen, der 2011 in der Angewandten Chemie erschienen ist, der kurz vor seinem Tod noch als letztes Manuskript auf den Weg gebracht wurde. Das ist ein beeindruckendes Dokument. Und wenn Sie hier den Titel lesen, von kleinen Kohlenstoffringen zu Porphyrinen, dann steckt hier alles drin. Das sind noch die vergleichsweise kleinen Kohlenstoffringe, die Sie hier sehen. Aber die Porphyrine, die waren dann ein, ich sag mal, Feld, zu dem er unglaubliche Beiträge geleistet hat. Die ganzen Isomeren, die ganzen Analoga, die Zusammenspiele zwischen Farbe und Struktur und sein berühmter Koffer mit den farbigen Lösungen, den er auf Vorträgen immer dabei hatte, haben viele meiner Generation noch eindrucksvoll selbst erleben dürfen. Seine ungeheuer ästhetischen Verbindungen haben es immer auch auf Titelseiten geschafft. Das sind nur zwei Titelseiten der Angewandten Chemie mit Vogel-Porphyrin-Analoga. Und diese Ästhetik dieser Strukturen hat auch Hermann Roth aufgegriffen, ein Kollege, Wissenschaftler, der aber auch immer ein zweites Standbein in der Kunst gefunden hat. Und Hermann Roth hat inspiriert durch ein Porphyrin diese Grafik auch hergestellt, von der wir eine ganze Reihe von Kopien bekommen haben und als Urkunde, anstelle einer Urkunde für die Vogel-Lecture, bekommen die Preisträger, die Vogel-Vortragenden, immer eine entsprechende Grafik mit diesem wunderbaren rotchen Porphyrin. Hier sehen Sie noch ein paar Impressionen aus den späten Jahren 2009, als Herr Berghessel und Mock Harning ihn zu Hause besucht haben, mit dem Motorrad, versteht sich. Und 2010, wenn ich das richtig erinnere, war das am Rande des 90. Geburtstages von Rolf Hüsgen. Ja, mit Emanuel Vogel haben wir einen berühmten und eindrucksvollen chemischen Vorfahren hier im Institut, dem wir wirklich huldigen möchten. Die Vogel-Lecture ist eine wunderbare Gelegenheit, das zu tun. Ich freue mich, dass auch immer so viele aus der Community, des Arbeitskreises von Herrn Vogel, zu diesen Lecturen kommen. Seien Sie alle besonders begrüßt, auch an dieser Stelle nochmal. Die Vogel-Lecture wurde 2014 zum ersten Mal als Preis vergeben mit einem Paukenschlag. Es war kein geringerer als Jean-Marie Lehn, der Nobelpreisträger von 1987, der diese Serie eröffnet hat. Und wenn Sie dann schauen, Frank Würtner, Jonathan Sessler, Dongo Kim, Andreas Hirsch, Henning Hopf und dieses Jahr Luisa De Cola. Ich glaube, das ist eine höchst ansehnliche Liste. Und wir wären nicht in der Lage, diese Vorlesung hier durchzuführen, wenn wir nicht ein Geschenk bekommen hätten, für das ich auch an dieser Stelle nochmal ganz, ganz herzlich danken möchte an Dr. Engelbert Zass, der selbst hier in Köln sein Studium zumindest begonnen und bei Emanuel Vogel, wenn ich das richtig erinnere, die Diplomarbeit gemacht hat, dann an die ETH Zürich ging, sich dort zum Leiter des Chemistry, Biology, Pharmacy Info Centers entwickelt hat und der auch auf höchstem internationalen Niveau zuletzt 2014 von der ACS für sein Wirken ausgezeichnet wurde. Herr Zass und seine Frau, Frau Zass, haben es möglich gemacht, dass wir diese Vogel-Lecture hier durchführen können. Hierfür tausend Dank auch an dieser Stelle nochmal. Ja, und bevor ich jetzt überleite und das Wort an meinen Kollegen Axel Griesbeck übergebe, noch eine kurze Aussicht. Wir haben in wenigen Wochen hier eine weitere Festveranstaltung. Und zwar hat die Mathematisch-Naturwissenschaftliche Fakultät beschlossen, Benjamin List die Ehrendoktorwürde zu verleihen. Benjamin List ist nicht nur einer der Nobelpreisträger für Chemie vom letzten Jahr, sondern er ist mit unserer Fakultät, mit diesem Department seit 2004 als Honorarprofessor eng verbunden. Und ich möchte Sie alle an der Stelle auch einladen, möglichst auch zu dieser Veranstaltung zu kommen. Es wird sicherlich eine spannende, würdige Veranstaltung. Aber genug der Werbung. Nun geht es weiter mit dem Höhepunkt der heutigen Veranstaltung. And I may switch to English now. You excuse me that I spoke in German all the time. I know you understand it. And I give the stage to Axel.
Dankeschön. Ja, ich mache aber trotzdem in Deutsch weiter. I switch in English to English in a second. Wir vertreten ja Frau Kajor zusammen, Herr Schmalz und ich. Herr Schmalz hat die Einführung gemacht mit dem Rückblick auf den Namensgeber dieser Veranstaltung und den Supporter, der diese Veranstaltung nun schon seit Jahren unterstützt hat. Und ich möchte Ihnen eine kurze Laudatio vorlesen, die Ihnen den Werdegang und die wissenschaftliche Arbeit von Frau de Cola beschreibt. Aber bevor ich das mache, muss ich doch eine Anmerkung noch zu diesem wunderschönen Farbkasten mit den Porphyrinen und Porphyrinderivaten machen. Die habe ich 1994 von Herrn Vogel gezeigt bekommen. Da war er ja noch im Institut, noch in deinem Büro, was du danach bezogen hast, Albrecht. Und ich dachte mir, und ich habe es ihm auch gesagt danach, wenn ein wirklich guter, berühmter Chemiker älter wird und reifer wird, dann wird er automatisch zum Photochemiker. Okay, das ist natürlich ein Scherz, aber es scheint ja doch wahr zu sein. Und bei Luisa de Cola ist es ein bisschen anders, weil sie war eigentlich immer eine Photochemikerin und sehr engagiert in der Photochemie. Und ich kenne sie seit 30 Jahren von IUPAC-Tagungen in der Photochemie. Und sie ist jetzt ein bisschen herausgegangen aus der Photochemie, hat aber immer noch viele sehr, sehr schöne Anwendungen und über einige wird sie auch heute erzählen. Der Laudatio-Text, den ich Ihnen jetzt verlese, den haben wir auch an die Pressestelle geschickt. Da wird er wahrscheinlich in etwas kürzerer Form veröffentlicht. Professor Luisa de Cola was born in 1960 and studied chemistry at the University of Messina, where she finished her education with a doctoral degree in 1983. After a postdoc and initial independent research periods, where she stayed in Richmond, United States of America, Bologna, and Fribourg in Switzerland. She was appointed assistant professor at the University of Bologna in 1990. From 1998 until now, she held chair positions at the University of Amsterdam, at the University of Münster. She held the chair of supramolecular chemistry at the University of Strasbourg, and since 2020, the chair at the University of Milano. What is not written here in the Laudatio is that you can reach a certain imagination. She's a truly European chemist. And I think this is something which is really important, especially nowadays, where Europe seems to fragment in a way. No? You remember the Brexit, or remember the recent election in Italy that we all feel a little bit depressed about. So this sounds like a fragmenting Europe, but she's really a sign that chemists and natural scientists and scientists in general can be truly European scientists. Luisa received numerous awards and prizes. Probably the most important is the IUPAC award as one of the distinguished women in chemistry and chemical engineering in 2011. She was admitted to the Académie Européenne in 2012 and to the Leopoldina National Academy of Science in Germany in 2014. Also in 2014, she was awarded the Chevalier de la Légion d'honneur by the French President François Hollande. And in 2015, she received the International Prize for Chemistry Tartufari from Académie de Lancey and the Catalan Sabatier Prize from the Spanish Royal Academy of Science. These are some prizes, so I don't mention all the others. Her scientific interests are focused around nanophotoscience and medicinal applications. She is interested in luminescent and electroluminescent materials for optical and electro-optical applications, as well as nanomaterials for medical imaging, diagnostics, and therapy. Porous nanomaterials are another specialty of Luisa de Cola. They can be used for the growth of biological cells and tissues, enabling new strategies for regenerative medicine. Other functionalities, including those of other nanoparticles, such as nanocontainers, can, in combination with luminescent effects, be used for selective transport, release, as well as in vitro and in vivo biomedical imaging. She has conducted research in various countries in Europe and around the world, and has also worked closely with industry. Thus, she's involved in more than 30 patents beside more than 300 publications. And I think now we're looking forward to your talk. Luisa, please.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and I'm really nervous, and it's really a great pleasure and honor to be with you today and to present the Emanuel Vogel lecture. I have to say I'm very pleased to see Frau Vogel. I did not expect that. Thank you for coming. And it is a big pleasure because, indeed, I met Professor Vogel in 1991 during a meeting that was organized by Professor Fertle and Vincenzo Balzani and a few other people. And I remember him very well, not only because of the beautiful lecture on porphyrins, but because, as he was already mentioned, he came with a little suitcase with these beautiful colored solutions. And I cannot forget this, I have to say. I was a very young assistant professor, and I was impressed because it's a way to communicate science in a very visual way that is very important, I believe, especially for us as a chemist, that sometimes I have a hard time to really explain a chemical process or what we do. And so the idea to really show what this compound looks like and what properties they have, for me, was really impressive. So it is, therefore, a real great pleasure to be with you today and to share some of my science. And even though I cannot talk about porphyrins, and I'm not an organic chemist, so a little bit disappointing, perhaps, but I can promise you a lot of colors in my lecture, so I will be inspired by the colors of Professor Vogel. So the talk is about something a little bit perhaps unusual for some of you, because it deals with the possibility to assemble molecules in a very precise manner. And we were very interested in this since many years, because for many, many decades we were trying to avoid self-assembly and to avoid aggregation. And then we discovered that when we can control this process, a huge number of interesting properties can come out. So I will try to show you something today about this self-assembly and how we can use perhaps this idea of aggregation for different things. And I would like also to show you something that is very much in the focus of my research at the moment, that is the possibility to stabilize systems that would not exist in solution using some kind of scaffold. And you will see in a moment what type of scaffold I'm talking about that can open indeed a lot of other interesting venues, not only for luminescence, but also for catalysis in vivo and many other properties. And this observation in solution that typically is in water for us can be really explored in much complex media like living system. And I will try to drive you in this living system from a biological point of view, because besides imaging, we discovered that this self-assembly can lead to extremely interesting self-healing but also regenerative process in animals like the one you see here, these little transparent polyps that are called hydra. And perhaps I will not promise to you to have a final step. I will show you also that this system in the confined space can lead to quite interesting sensing, so it's connected to the second part. But let me give you a little introduction, because maybe not all of you are familiar with what I'm going to discuss with you, and in particular the luminescence of platinum compound. And there is a little story here that I want to mention with two slides that is about the properties of this compound. Because when we make platinum compounds and we shine light on this solution, we will observe absorption, of course, of this compound that typically is in the blue or in the visible region, and essentially it occurs because we have both the d orbital of the metal and the pi orbital of the ligands that are coordinated to the metal ions. So typically we identify these two transitions as what we call metal to ligand charge transfer or ligand-centered transition when we deal with pi-pi star absorption. And this is always true, no matter which ligand we have around the platinum and which are coordinated to the ion. However, platinum compounds are flat molecules. These are platinum two. And so what happens is that often this geometrical arrangement can lead to a stacking of the system, especially if we have conjugated ligand around the platinum units. And therefore, this platinum compound can start to stack within each other and then can start to form assemblies that have completely different properties from the monomeric species in solution. So in other words, what's happening is that during this process of aggregation, we have the d zeta square orbitals that are the one perpendicular to the square planar plane start to get together, so they start to interact electronically, and this interaction leads to a destabilization of the d orbital and that increasing the energy of the HOMO. And so this is essentially translated with the fact that when in the stacking, in the aggregates species, we observe a shift in the absorption and eventually in the emission properties of this compound. And so we can see immediately by our own eyes that something is happening, because we will see immediately a change, for instance, in the bright emission of this species. And this is a phenomenon that has been discussed for many years in the literature, because it's so unique that you can observe by your own eyes this phenomena. And one of the first person who started this field is Richard Eisenberg in Rochester in the United States, and many others followed. And what is interesting about this process is also that we change the nature of this excited state. So, for instance, if you look at this very simplistic diagram, we go from a lowest excited state that was a pi-pi star state to what we call metal-metal ligand charge transfer state. And this was explored by us many years ago, and indeed it is a pleasure to show this slide, because it represents one of the first examples where we made organic light-emitting diodes using the aggregates and not the monomeric species. And these devices were made here in Cologne by Klaus Merholz, that unfortunately cannot be here today. And so for me it's a great pleasure to show how this story started, because it started through this collaboration in Cologne. And so we made a device with this specific compound that was also self-assembling very strongly and giving a very bright emission with emission quantum yield close to unit. But of course the story did not stop with this example, and we started to design different compounds where you can explore this aggregation and you can explore how you can arrange this formation in solution of the aggregates, for instance, to form fibers that can be aligned in order to give a polarized emission. And so you can really deposit this fiber in a special way in order to give rise to new properties. But I have to say that the real breakthrough came when once we made this new compound. And the idea was essentially to combine the properties of the square planar metal compounds with a surfactant properties. So we were thinking, well, a way to really push the aggregation to a certain limit would be to really design a kind of surfactant molecule. And now you see the design, because you recognize in this part that is coordinated to the platinum, a very hydrophobic unit containing also these CF3 groups, while in the tail we started to add polyethylene glycol chain that gives rise to a solubility in water. So it's an hydrophilic unit. And just to, without showing too much spectroscopy, I can show you only this slide, where you see immediately that when you dissolve the compound, for instance, in an organic solvent like dioxane, you start to see the blue emission of this compound in solution. However, if you add a little bit of water in this dioxane solution, and water dioxane are perfectly miscible, what happens is what you see with your own eyes, that the blue emission disappears, and we have this very bright orange emission coming out very strongly from our flask. Well, since we are scientists, I have to show you a little bit of spectroscopy to show indeed that this emission that was at the beginning, the emission of the monomeric species, so it's a ligand-centered emission, indeed turn to this aggregate emission with an emission quantum yield of 94%. So this was quite exciting. But doing this research, we realized that there was something that we were missing in the photophysics. There was some kind of transient species that we could not detect by a simple fluorimeter. And so one of my PhD students, who is now a professor in Padua, decided to look at this in a quite unusual way for a photochemist. He decided to follow the aggregation process in a confocal microscope. So he took a droplet of this solution that was essentially containing water, and then he looked what happened in real time. And so what you will observe in the next three slides are just movies from the confocal without any change of any type. And now you come and you start to see that in water you form these little aggregates that are red, deep red, exactly corresponding to what I show you when we add water in the dioxane. But if you are very patient, means 4-6 hours, you start to see some little green spot. And this is what we were missing in our experiment. We never observed any green emission, because this is a transient species, so it will disappear. And so we decided to change the ratio between water and dioxane, and we repeat the same experiment with more dioxane. And now you see immediately that this green species is not anymore a dot. It's really a rod that grows, but eventually will evolve towards the equilibrium. And therefore, the blue species that we see forming is the equilibrium, is the thermodynamic stable species. But what is beautiful in this slide is that what you are watching with me is the self-assembly of small molecules in real time. Like I said, without any trick or without any sophisticated equipment, just a microscope. And of course, if you increase the amount of dioxane, things get viral, if you like it, and then you see that essentially the green get predominant, you don't see the red anymore, and even is eaten, we call it molecular cannibalism, by this blue species that is, of course, the thermodynamic species. So this was quite exciting, and of course, we did not expect such a three-stage evolution of the self-assembly of this molecule. And we were quite lucky because, as you can see from the beautiful color, each assembly had a different color with a fantastic emission quantum yield. And so we started to rationalize what the color were due to. And we measured the platinum-platinum distance using SACS and 2D VACS in order to see indeed that in the blue thermodynamic stable species, the final product, you see the blue emission that is given by essentially a non-electronic interaction between the platinum, because the distance is above 3.6 angstrom. So essentially there was no DD interaction in this case. But if you measure the distance in the red emissive part, so in the red little dots that are indeed aggregates of 100 nanometer in diameter and they are spherical, you see that the distance is only 3.2 angstrom. I know that for the students, maybe 0.4 angstrom is irrelevant, but electronically speaking, this is a very strong interaction. And so you see this beautiful correlation between the platinum-platinum interactions and the colors of the emission. So at this point we send the paper to Nature, and Nature reject the paper, and we send the paper to Nature Chemistry. And the editor was very excited about the comments of the referent. He asked us to design a cover for the journal. And since I love movies, I want to share you what was my thought at that point. And so it was the time of Star Wars. And now you see something quite interesting, because you see the fight between, you know, the little guy and the Lucas, the good guy. And perhaps you notice something already in this little video, that the good guy, that is Lucas with the blue sword, is the guy that at the end survived, because the blue is the thermodynamic species. And so we decided that we should have a cover with Yota. And it was perfect, because indeed, this was our confocal picture. We did not have to manipulate anything. We just add the little guy with a sword in his hand. But you know, editors sometimes are strange people, because they thought, oh my lord, you know, we're going to have a fight with the Lucas film. And so they decided to remove the little guy. And so this is the real cover. I'm sorry to disappoint you. Anyway, so if you want to know more, it's, everything is in the paper. But at this point, something that I mentioned to you was that we would see as a transient species this green aggregate that we could never catch. That's why I did not give you any data about the distance, because it was really a transient. It was disappearing in a few minutes. And this was the time where we were working on a very special things in my lab that we call nano cages. And these are cages that I will show you in a moment. They are made of silica, of glass. They are transparent. And so we thought, well, can we stabilize this transient species and then release it whenever you wish in order to really see the evolution of the last stage? And so let me tell you a few things about these cages that we make for completely different reasons, I have to confess you. And they look very beautiful. So these are made by a template synthesis, using a micelle as a templating agent and condensed silica around the template. But there is a trick, because if you do this in a normal way, you would get mesoporous silica. So you would get that the template forms pores and you get the regular mesoporous silica. But if you change the pH during the course of the reaction and you start with acidic pH, the polymerization, the condensation of silica at low pH is linear. And when you increase the pH and you go to basic pH, it's in 3D, so it's three-dimensional. And so what happens is that you get a completely different morphology, even though the size is identical, 20 nanometer. And we did an extra little trick to make these cages, that was to introduce into the silica framework some kind of chemical groups, organic chemical groups, that can break on demand. So the idea was to have not just an alternation of silicon oxygen, silicon bond, like in any piece of glass, but to have some kind of, I call blue box, but that's nothing to do with Frese Stoddart, but with some kind of organic groups that could somehow split apart on demand. And these organic groups for us, the one that I will show you today, are disulfide group. And since you are all chemists, you know very well that disulfide can be indeed reduced to tiles, and in the reduction they split apart because they form two tiles from a single disulfide. So let me show you a little bit more about this material, because it's quite interesting. So this is the morphology of the material. And the morphology is unique because indeed it's not a mesoporous material, but it's a material with a single pore. So essentially what happens is that the template that was sticking inside here template the formation of the silica, and when you do tomography or reconstruction by Relion program, thanks to the help of Patrick Schulz, I have to say, we were able to really see the shape, the morphology of the material, but also the size of the void, of the pore inside, that is 11 nanometer. So we have a single pore of 11 nanometer, and we have these doors here that are only between 3 and 4 nanometer. So that's why we call nano cages. It's like a cage for birds. And the beauty is that each single nanomaterial is identical. So we can make extremely monodisperse cages. But I mentioned to you that this material can break on demand. And indeed, if you expose this material to a reducing agent, like the one we have in our body, that is glutathione, the particle fall apart. So you decompose the particle in few hours. So you can really break the material and release whatever is inside the material. But I don't want to talk about drug release today. I want to talk about assembly. And now you understand where I am aiming to, because we want to capture this intermediate species in solution and then release it on demand in certain condition. And so if I go back to what I just told you a few minutes ago, we can imagine to trap this out of equilibrium species, that is the green emitting fiber that you saw before, adding our cage into the solution and hoping that some of this cage will be able to catch the aggregate. And if this is the case, means that this aggregate cannot escape from the silica. So they will leave not minutes, but hours, maybe days. And they will be released only when we decide to break the cage. So without too much photophysics, I want to show you only this slide that explains you the process. Because when you compare the platinum that you just saw in the movie, in the best case, the green species survives less than 2 hours. And in our case, when the platinum is encapsulated into the cage, you see that we can go up to 2 days, 3 days, without any release and any change in the species. And so this was quite exciting for us. And we decided indeed to look at the breaking at this point, so to see if it was possible to really break this material in very special condition. So these are just the emission intensity, just to show you some data. And so what we did was to take this cage where we have encapsulated this non-stable species, and we let them to incubate with ELA cells. And now you see that the species are indeed internalized. I don't know if you can see from the slide. You can see this little orange spot inside the cell, because they are still inside the cage, so they have not been released. But if you wait a few hours, and exactly 8 hours, what you start to see is the formation of the blue species. So you see the polymerization inside the cell of the monomeric species. So you can see the reaction in real time of the species that have been released, and they are free to react to form the polymer. And of course, you can monitor the time. You can monitor the length of this polymer. And so if you know more, again, this is our paper out. So at this point, we were thinking, wow, this is great, you know, because you could imagine that instead of platinum, I can have many things, you know, inside these cages. I could imagine a catalyst, or I could imagine a prodrug, or I could imagine whatever you want. And we also realized that when the platinum aggregates, because there is no oxygen quenching, this aggregates lives in water inside the cell microseconds. So they are the best dyes that you could imagine to do time-gated, because they do not live nanoseconds. They live several microseconds, and they are extremely bright. And we knew that because we have indeed published this paper before the cages, where we were looking at imaging in vitro with this material, where we designed a different, slightly different type of system with hydroxy groups, where you can see here the excitation spectrum and the emission that comes from the aggregates. But what is interesting is indeed that in this excitation, you see that because of the aggregates, I can really excite the molecules into the visible. And this is quite important, because when you are in cells, you don't want to excite at 300 nanometer, because you will destroy the cell. And so we can see indeed that the aggregate inside the cell exciting in the visible. So here is an example of this emission inside cells. And just to point out one interesting thing, if I look at this compound with these CF3 groups, we notice something very nice, that in a few minutes it was migrating inside the nucleus, and in particular is inside the nucleolus. So there is an activity that could be also potentially interesting in medicinal chemistry of this compound that aggregates inside the nucleus and gives rise to this beautiful yellow emission that is much brighter than DAPI or HURST, that they are the normal nuclear staining for cells. And like I mentioned before, you can even excite up to 550 nanometer. So we have a big range of wavelength where we can still see the emission in the nucleus upon excitation in the visible. So at this point, we were very ambitious and we thought, well, can we see the self-assembly in living system? And what would be the, you know, the cause of this assembly besides the emission in living system? And so we team up with a group of Claudia Tortiglioni, who is at the CNRS in Naples, and we decided to explore a little animal that is called Hydra vulgaris in Latin, that is essentially a polyp that lives in sweet water. It's an interesting little animal because the body is completely transparent, it has a very simple nervous system, everything essentially is a stomach, and so essentially you can give the compound to be eaten by the animal just giving the platinum in water. Of course, we have to make a platinum compound water soluble. That's what we did, and I will show you in a minute the formula. But there is something interesting that I have to tell you about the biology of this animal. And the biology of this animal is connected indeed to the different type of cells that are either in the internal part of the animal or in the external part. And if I look a little bit more in detail, without going too much in biology, this animal has been studied forever because it has an incredible regeneration system. So it is able to produce stem cells that are very efficient in the cellular differentiation, so that if you cut the tentacles of this animal, the tentacles will regrow in a few days. And so people have used this as a kind of model for the regeneration of tissue. And this is relevant for what I'm going to tell you in a second. So let me tell you which compound we can use. Because at this point, we have to change system, as I mentioned to you. And we decided to go for this special compound for two reasons. First of all, it's a charged compound, and if you make the chloride salt, it's water soluble. And the second reason is that this group quenched the emission of the platinum in water. So that means that when it's not aggregated, the pyridinium salt will quench the emission quite dramatically. But when it is aggregated, the emission is light up again, and therefore it's much more emissive than in solution. It also aggregates, you can see by SEM, we form this beautiful structure that are kind of roundish nanoparticle. And since it is water soluble, the animal can eat it. And so we decided to look at the dose for the toxicity of this platinum compound inside the animal. And so what you see here are the hydra that have been fed with 10 micromolar compound, and these are the different time, 20 micromolar, 50 micromolar, 100 micromolar. I don't think we need to be a biologist to see that 100 micromolar is very toxic for the animal. The 50 start to be toxic after 3 days, but the 20 and the 10 and the 5 are non-toxic at all. So the animal has a regular cycle where essentially it can survive with the platinum in the body. But is the platinum in the body? Yes. I mean, we can see. As soon as you shine light on the animal, you can really see the aggregate of the platinum into the branches, into these beautiful tentacles, but also into the body. But what we notice I don't have to show any spectroscopy here, is that the branches are always much brighter than anything else. And so we started to look at the different cells that are present in the body and into the branches of the animal. And what we notice is that a lot of this platinum goes to this nematocyte. And I forgot to point this out. The nematocytes are where the stem cells are produced. So it's essentially responsible for this regeneration. But nevertheless, they are in different type of cells. So there is not a very specific internalization of the platinum compound into cells. Of course, you can also calculate the amount of platinum that really reach the body of the animal, because you can do ICP mass spectrometry. So you can calculate the number of complex that the animal has been eaten during this process. But then my student, who was a visiting student in Naples, she decided to look an interesting process. So essentially she was feeding the animal, and then she had a control, the regular, you know, just food for the animal. And then she noticed something weird, that whenever she was adding the platinum into the water, the animal was growing faster. So typically it takes 1 week for the animal to be developed. And the curve that she noticed was essentially showing that already with 2 micromolar platinum, the animal was growing much faster. So already essentially after a few days, after 6 days, the animal was formed. Already after 3 days, we could see the tentacles. And this was quite weird, so we started to do a lot of biological experiments in order to understand what was going on in this animal, why they would grow faster when we feed with platinum. And so one experiment they did was to indeed calculate the number of stem cells produced versus the control experiment when we feed the animal with the platinum. And this was quite astonishing, because what we saw was that we were producing 30% more stem cell when the platinum was aggregating inside this animal. And really when it was aggregating, because a control experiment showed that monomeric species of platinum were not doing anything else. And so at this point we start a long story that finally ended very recently, in order to understand which gene was responsible for this regulation of the stem cell. And so they screen through transcriptometry all the genes of this animal, and they found out that the gene was affected is this HIMIC1. This is a very important gene because it's also present in humans. So it's not only present in this simple molecule, in this simple organism. And they regulate indeed the stem cell regulation. And for this type of animals, there is essentially a negatively regulating stem cell, and the stem cell essentially can renew in the presence of this platinum. So at this point we were wondering, how does the platinum act on this gene? I mean, what is really the reason why we have this stem cell production? And at this point I have to say we have to speculate a little bit, because what we noticed was that these aggregates of platinum were acting like the superoxidized dismutase act. So we look at the different, the SOD and also this catalase process. And what we noticed was that whenever we had the platinum, the enzymatic process was much more effective than in the absence of the platinum. So what I can tell you is that when the platinum aggregates, it changed dramatically its electrochemical properties. In particular, it's much easier to be oxidized than the platinum to monomeric species. And so we think that this aggregation brings a kind of antioxidant effect. And this can be also be explained because indeed, when you treat the cell of these branches of the tentacles in the real animal, for instance, with a reducing agent, you see a change in the molecular structure of the cell. And this is indeed a phenomena that has been much studied by the biologists. And it's true also, when you add the platinum compound, you start to see this dysregulation of the cells. So there is something to do with this strong antioxidant behavior of this platinum compound that rises only when the platinum are aggregates, otherwise it's very difficult to oxidize the platinum too. So at this point we were wondering, is this unique for this animal, or is this a more general thing? And before going to vertebrates, we decided to explore another animal that is also transparent, which is a little bit bigger. It lives in seawater. It's called anemone, or starlet sea anemone. And now you see that it's a little bit more complex animal. And what is interesting in this animal is that, like the zebrafish, is formed by a single cell. So the single cell grow and form the entire animal. At the beginning form this animal that is called planula, and then from the planula all the tentacles grow and then becomes an adult. And again, this process is a very long process. So we look again at the possibility to see this regeneration of the animal. And again, we observe something very spectacular, Because in the untreated animal, after 6 days, you almost have no formation of tentacles. In the treated animals, you have already the tentacles after 3 days. So this is quite amazing. It looks like magic. I'm a little bit scared to present this data because it's very unnatural that you can form the animals, a full animal, in such a short time without any consequence for the animal. So this is where we stand. Of course, now we are trying on a different animal. We are trying on C. elegans. That is a worm that contains a nervous apparatus in order to see if we can prolong the life of these animals. So if this effect is also much more complex systems. So do I still have 5 minutes? Okay. So then since I have 5 minutes, I want to conclude and show you some results, going back a little bit on the idea to encapsulate things in porous material. And this goes to a direction that is completely different. It goes towards sensing. And together with a fantastic guy, his name is Frank Biederman from KIT, who was a former postdoc of mine and who is doing the habilitation. Some time ago, we decided to look at a material that we studied for many years. They're called zeolites. These are aluminosilicates, different from the cage that I showed you before, because the cage have no alumina. And these aluminosilicates have a characteristic property that is a crystalline porous material. So you see a crystal structure here, where in the case of zeolite L, all the pores are aligned. So they are unidimensional channels, if you like it, where the entrance is very narrow, 7.1 angstrom. And in the past, we studied this zeolite a lot because we were fascinated by the diffusion and release of molecules from this channel. And so we made zeolite of any size, any dimension, also in collaboration with John Calzaferri from University of Bern. At this point, you realize that having this pore so narrow, we can entrap specific molecules. And what is interesting is that the pores are so narrow that the molecules that are entrapped cannot rotate. So you have a completely anisotropic material at the end of the story. And so we decided to use these properties that we can exchange, for instance, the sodium or the potassium, that is the counter ion of the alumina, with positively charged dyes in order to entrap the dyes inside this negatively porous material. And so we decided to look for some kind of, we call suprasensor, in the sense that if you try to encapsulate a very well-known dye that Klaus, of course, taught us many years ago, you could imagine that you can derive some kind of perylene, for instance, attaching methylating this nitrogen, in order to have this material that are positively charged, and so they will go straight into the pores because of the negative charge of the zeolites. And at this point, we were wondering, what happens to this dye in the moment I come in with a metabolite, like, for instance, a neurotransmitter? And the neurotransmitters are extremely interesting because they are small molecules and they are also positively charged, most of them, because most of them contain indeed amino groups that in physiological condition will be protonated. And so we were trying to see if this entrapment could lead to a change in the emission of the dyes that was immobilized inside. Well, I don't have to do so much electron transfer theory to show you the result visually, like would have done Professor Fogel. And so what you see here is our starting material with zeolite, completely, of course, white and completely not emissive. Once we put inside the dye, we call D1, you see the beautiful emission of the zeolites that are filled with the material. As soon as you add a drop of serotonin, boom, the emission is gone. Nanomolar concentration, amazing, you think. And so this is indeed what's happening. What's happening is there is an electron transfer between the dye that is inside and the serotonin. And at this point, we decided to measure association constant inside the zeolite, and we use thermocalorimetric analysis. And so what we saw was that the binding constant between our serotonin, but also different neurotransmitter, was much, much better than any work published so far, and was very close indeed to the natural system that we have as a receptor. But of course you would wonder, well, is this selective? I mean, is serotonin special? What about the other neurotransmitter? And so we did indeed a selectivity trial. So we had a different type of neurotransmitter or even molecules that are very similar in structure to the serotonin, like indole or tryptophan. And what you observe is that none of the molecules would give any signal except for the serotonin. And what is interesting is that it is a combination of size and charge. So if the molecule is uncharged, it will not enter. So like molecule like the indole will never enter. But if it is too big, like it has a carboxylate here, it will not enter here because it does not enter because of the size. So we have a kind of exclusion that is based on size and charge. And so this was quite nice because you can build up a very simple sensor combining this nanomaterial with an hydrogel. And then you can let, for instance, a biofluid like urines in order to diffuse into the hydrogel and look what happens. And indeed, when you do that, you will be able to observe the quenching of the emission related to the presence of a certain neurotransmitter. And of course, you can recover the system. So you can concentrate the neurotransmitter, and then you can evaluate how much of this was present. I'm sorry that the video, I think, it doesn't work here. No. And so in collaboration with Elisa Dest in Heidelberg, we show indeed that you can light up on and off depending on the concentration of the neurotransmitter. So this was quite exciting, and we rationalized this with a modeling that was done in collaboration with Professor Wenzel, where you see very nicely the dye that is inside the zeolite, and then the serotonin that cannot really pass through, but is close enough to lead to this electron transfer reaction, so to the quenching reaction that you observe. So at this point we thought, well, does it really work in biofluids from patients or from people? And so we took samples. I have to confess you, these are samples from my students, people that do not consume coffee. So these are here, these are with coffee. And then we add a different amount of serotonin. And this reflects indeed in the biofluids that you can really monitor this serotonin in a real sample. And then we did an experiment that is a little bit more traumatic, I have to say, in collaboration with Heidelberg, where essentially what we did was to implant in a microendoscope these nanomaterials, and then through a little hole in the mouse scalp, we penetrate with our system in order to see if the sensing could be also work in vivo. And so what we did was to measure, in this case, adrenaline when the mouse was sleeping and when the mouse was running. And what you observe here is the Raman spectrum, essentially, of the dopamine signal when he's sleeping. So this is essentially a kind of weak signal. But as soon as the mouse is awake, depending on the running speed, you can see that all the signal increased dramatically. So you can really detect the neurotransmitter that has been produced by the motion of the animal. Like I said, this is something I would not recommend to do, to have an endoscope implanted, but since I was talking earlier with our colleagues, so I think this can be done. So with this story, I would like to finish and with a perspective, because we started to look at activity of enzyme inside the cell. This is quite an interesting story, because it's true that you can capture a metabolite that is already present, but it's also true that you can capture a product of an enzymatic reaction. So you could imagine to have a design for which, for instance, during an enzymatic reaction, you produce, like in this case is the thyroxine decarboxylase, you can produce a product that can be encapsulated, so you can monitor in real time the enzymatic reaction, even in cells. So this is a perspective, and I would like to complete my talk, and I would like to thank again for the fantastic organization of today's afternoon, and of course the funding for this support. And I would like to thank my people. So this is a picture of the groups, except for the master students, who are not in this picture. I'm sorry for them. This is the Mario Negri building. It's one of the places where I have my labs. And I would like to thank all of them. This fantastic group of, it's a new group. Only three people moved from Strasbourg. And I would like to thank the financial support, in particular the European community that trust our work very much. I really thank them for their invaluable support. And I would like to thank all of you for your patience and your attention. And I wish to invite you to come to Milano as soon as you want. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Luisa, for, I think, this truly impressive lecture that spanned from chemistry to photophysics, photochemistry, biology, and medicinal applications. I think that's really, truly fascinating. I think we have a little bit of time over for questions. If somebody has, Albrecht.
Do you want to use the microphone?
Yeah, congratulations to the wonderful biological effects that you see in Hydra. I'm wondering what happens if you exchange platinum for another square planar metal, let's say nickel too, or if you leave the metal out completely.
Yeah. So what we learned was that indeed we need this aggregation of platinum because monomeric species do not act like this. So it's not the metal itself that really caused the effect, but it's the aggregation that caused the change, in our opinion, in the redox properties of the system. So in principle, surely you can go with no metals, even you know, with the molecules that upon aggregation can modulate dramatically their oxidation or reduction potential, and therefore you know, they can act as a reducing agent, like in our case. It acts like a huge glutathione, I don't know how to say, into the system. So we are thinking about this very much, but you could even imagine at this point to design also drugs, you know, where they are completely inactive when they aggregate and when disaggregate, so do the opposite as well. So to answer your question, yes, you can think about no metals, or you know, you can think other type of metals where disaggregation can be induced, or systems, you know, where this modulation can trigger a biological question. So this is something that we were very much looking for, but at the beginning we did not notice, yeah.
Our colleague from Bonn. Doesn't matter.
Thanks, Luisa, for this fantastic talk. I got a question concerning this glass porous materials.
Yes.
What's the driving force for the organic or organometallic compound to get inside?
Yeah. So typically, these are material is a silica material. So typically, they are negatively charged. So anything that is positive will be electrostatically attracted and eventually will go into the pores. And of course, you can modify both the surface and the interior of the holes with groups that are hydrophobic, for instance, or of a different charge. Typically, we attach amino groups or arginine in order to make positive instead of negative. And for neutral compound, this is more tricky. So the way we encapsulate neutral compound is by sublimation. So essentially, we go to the vapor phase with the compound, and then under high vacuum, you have a depressurization inside the pores, and so the molecule kind of is sucked in the pores. So there are different ways to do it. But in the case of the platinum, we use impregnation because this is a transient species, so we were not even sure that we would capture in the best condition possible this species, but eventually we did, yeah. So it's a driving force from the charge.
Actually, I don't quite know what he means by driving force, but the mechanism of the cell uptake is a little bit not clear.
Yeah.
Neither a polar nor an amphiphilic species goes inside.
Yeah.
You need a kind of random distribution of polar and non-polar groups.
Yeah.
Think of Francesco Stellacci,
yeah,
or Tanya,
yeah,
Weilsberg.
Yeah.
So how does the stuff, I could also mention, say, a adenovirus doesn't go into a stem cell because there is not the right receptor.
Yeah.
You need to redress the surface.
Yeah.
What then is the mechanism of the cell uptake?
Yeah. So we are studying this very much in detail. I can tell you some news about this. So in our case, is exactly what you mentioned. Because we have these disulfide bonds, part of the system is hydrophobic, because we insert the disulfide with an aliphatic chain and two silanes on the side. And so we have hydrophobic units within silica that is hydrophilic. And what we noticed was, and this is a published paper in ACS Nano, is that if we compare with pure silica that is negatively charged all over the places and is very hydrophilic, first of all, the internalization time is reduced for the same number of particles, from 50 minutes to 7 minutes. And second one is that they escape macrophages. And, you know, this is amazing because all the silica is eaten by macrophages. And so the mechanism indeed is receptor connected. So essentially...
May I interrupt? Does that mean that the platinum complex, if you like, transfection, would all only be carried inside if you have a carrier or a kind
yeah.
of... Oh, I see.
Yeah, so in this case, because this platinum compound is neutral, so it will be water insoluble anyway also, so you cannot feed the cell except if you dissolve in the MSO or something, it will never enter the cell. And the same for the negatively one. It will never enter. It will stick as a self-assembly system, but outside the membrane. So we have a beautiful picture of that. The positively charged compound, the one we use for the Hydra, goes inside the cell. Sure. And that's why we select that and not any other water-soluble compound, because we need the positive charge to carry it inside the cell. So in this case, the cage is the carrier. Without it, the platinum will never get in, independently if it is assembled or disassembled. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for this wonderful talk.
Thank you.
Exactly to that picture here, you're saying that it's a cage and something's locked inside the cage.
Yeah.
But the size of the cage is 20 nanometers.
Yeah.
Yeah? A DNA is 2 nanometers. Yeah?
Yeah.
So it would like, yeah, if you're locking people into a cage where the poles are 20 meters apart. Yeah. So how can you think that the molecules that you're locking in the cage only assemble to the poles and not in the hole in the
no.
center of the cage?
Yep. No, we have a proof that they are inside, because when the platinum is inside, the crystallinity change completely. So if you measure XRD, I think I have a picture if you want, I can show you. If you measure XRD of the system, what you will observe is that the peaks of the platinum stay crystalline, but all the peaks shift when they are inside the cages. And so we can really distinguish that the platinum is inside this structure very nicely. And also the lifetime and the quantum yield change compared with the one outside. And we have a little shift towards the green. So I did not point it out in the picture, but if you look, so that's why we draw a little bit different in color. So essentially I don't think I have the emission spectrum. I don't have the emission spectrum. So we have a combination of photophysics that is different inside and outside. But what is really diagnostic, I would say, is the XRD. It's very impressive. We have done this with a derivative of a cis platinum compound that we are publishing at the moment in ACS that is used for... is a lung disease. I cannot remember at this moment. And what we observe is indeed that the platinum is inside and all the peaks are really shifted when they are inside. And then when they are released, you get back the spectrum of the real crystalline platinum compound. So it's a way to really monitor, I would say, is a good way to do it. Yeah. And you can also see by TM, because when the platinum is inside, the cavity is a little bit wider. I don't know if you can see from this picture, you cannot probably appreciate. But essentially what you see is that where you have the hole, you have this white spot. When you have the platinum, everything becomes black, because the platinum is so electronically dense that by TM you don't see any more the pore. And so you really see it by different way, or you can measure nitrogen adsorption to have an idea of the quantity. Typically, we quantify the platinum by ICP mass, so we do mass spectrometry or TGA. Yeah.
I also very much enjoyed your talk, and I was fascinated by your very selective sensing of serotonin in the presence of tryptophan and indole and others. But could you distinguish, for instance, between dopamine and serotonin, which are similar in size and also are both positive charged?
Yes, we were able to distinguish. It's not so distinctive like for the others I show, but we can still distinguish. So the trick now is to work with larger pores because, you know, the zeolites are constrained by the crystallinity. But if you make mesoporous silica, where you can decorate the interior, you could also have a specific receptor inside. And so you can really drive, you know, this selectivity for specific molecules quite well. And so you could imagine to really develop a set of sensors, that's what we are trying at the moment, for specific metabolites. We are looking at Alzheimer's disease in particular. Well, not drilling the hole like I showed you at the last slide, but being a little bit less dramatic, so working with biofluids, in order to concentrate the metabolites. Because one of the problems is also that we have so few of these molecules into the biofluids, that normally you don't get them. You don't have a mean to concentrate. While with this nanomaterial, it's very easy, the concentration, because essentially you just centrifuge and you collect everything, you dissolve the silica, and then you essentially monitor what is inside. So it's a very simple and cheap, I would say, methodology.